హలో ఆల్, వెల్కమ్ టు అవర్ యూట్యూబ్ ఛానల్. జై శ్రీ జవాజీ. నేమ్ ఆఫ్ ద బుక్ బౌండరీస్, వెన్ టు సే ఎస్, హౌ టు సే నో టు టేక్ కంట్రోల్ ఆఫ్ యువర్ లైఫ్. ఆథర్స్ డాక్టర్ హెన్రీ క్లౌ అండ్ డాక్టర్ టౌన్సెంట్. పార్ట్ 1, వాట్ ఆర్ బౌండరీస్. యూనిట్ 2, వాట్ డస్ అ బౌండరీ లుక్ లైక్, కంటిన్యూస్. ఎగ్జాంపుల్స్ ఆఫ్ బౌండరీస్. Boundaries are anything that helps to differentiate you from someone else or shows where you begin and end. Here are some examples of boundaries. Skin. The most basic boundary that defines you is your physical skin. People often use this boundary as a metaphor for saying that their personal boundaries have been violated. He really gets under my skin. Your physical self is the first way that you learn that you are separate from others. As an infant, you slowly learn that you are different from the mother or father who cuddles you. The skin boundary keeps the good in and the bad out. It protects your blood and bones, holding them on the inside and all together. It also keeps germs outside, protecting you from infection. At the same time, skin has openings that let the good in like food and the bad out like waste products. Victims of physical and sexual abuse often have a poor sense of boundaries. Early in life, they were taught that the property did not really begin at their skin. Others could invade their property and do whatever they wanted. As a result, they have difficulty establishing boundaries later in life. Words. In the physical world, a fence or some other kind of structure usually delineates a boundary. In the spiritual world, fences are invisible. Nevertheless, you can create good protective forces with your words. The most basic boundary setting word is no. It lets others know that you exist apart from them and that you are in control of you. Being clear about your no and your yes is a theme that runs throughout the Bible. No is a confrontational word. The Bible says that we are to confront people we love, saying, "No, that behavior is not okay. I will not participate in that." The word no is also important in setting limits on abuse. Many passages of scripture urge us to say no to others' sinful treatment of us. The Bible also warns us against giving to others reluctantly or under compulsion. People with poor boundaries struggle with saying no to the control, pressure, demands, and sometimes the real needs of others. They feel that if they say no to someone, they will endanger their relationship with that person, so they passively comply but inwardly resent. Sometimes a person is pressuring you to do something, other times the pressure comes in from your own sense of what you should do. If you cannot say no to this external or internal pressure, you have lost control of your property and not enjoying the fruit of self-control. Your words also define your property for others as you communicate your feelings, intentions, or dislikes. It is difficult for people to know where you stand when you do not use words to define your property. God does this when He says, "I like this and I hate that," or "I will do this and I will not do that." Your words let people know where you stand and thus give them a sense of the edges that help identify you. "I don't like it when you yell at me" gives people a clear message about how you conduct relationships and lets them know the rules of your yard. Truth. Knowing the truth about God and His property puts limits on you and shows you His boundaries. Realizing the truth of His unchangeable reality helps you to defend yourself in relation to Him. When He says that you will reap what you sow, for example, you either define yourself in relation to that reality or continue to get injured if you try to go against it. To be in touch with God's truth is to be in touch with reality, and to live in accord with that reality makes for a better life. Satan is the great distorter of reality. Recall in the garden when he tempted Eve to question God's boundaries and His truth. The consequences were disastrous. There is always safety in the truth, whether it be knowing God's truth or knowing the truth about yourself. Many people live scattered and tumultuous lives, trying to live outside of their own boundaries, not accepting and expressing the truth of who they are. Honesty about who you are gives you the biblical value of integrity or oneness. Geographical distance. Proverbs 22:3 says that the prudent man sees the evil and hides himself. Sometimes physically removing yourself from a situation will help maintain the boundaries. You can do this to replenish yourself physically, emotionally, and spiritually after you have given to your limit, as Jesus often did. Or you can remove yourself to get away from danger and put limits on evil. The Bible urges us to separate from those who continue to hurt us and to create a safe place for ourselves. Removing yourself from the situation will also cause the one who is left behind to experience a loss of fellowship that may lead to changed behavior. When a relationship is abusive, many times the only way to finally show the other person that your boundaries are real is to create space until they are ready to deal with the problem. The Bible supports the idea of limiting togetherness for the sake of binding evil. Time. Taking time off from a person or a project can be a way of regaining ownership over some out-of-control aspect of your life where boundaries need to be set. Adult children who have never spiritually and emotionally separated from their parents often need time away. They have spent their whole lives embracing and keeping and have been afraid to refrain from embracing and to throw away some of their outgrown ways of relating. They need to spend some time building boundaries against the old ways and creating new ways of relating that for a while may feel alienating to their parents. This time apart usually improves the relationship with their parents. Emotional distance. Emotional distance is a temporary boundary to give your heart the space it needs to be safe. It is never a permanent way of living. People who have been in abusing relationships need to find a safe place to begin to thaw out emotionally. Sometimes, in abusive marriages, the abused spouse needs to keep emotional distance until the abusive partner begins to face his or her problems and become trustworthy. You should not continue to set yourself up for hurt and disappointment. If you have been in an abusive relationship, you should wait until it is safe and until real patterns of change have been demonstrated before you go back. Many people are too quick to trust someone in the name of forgiveness and not make sure that the other is producing fruit in keeping with repentance. To continue to open yourself up emotionally to an abusive or addicted person without seeing true change is foolish. Forgive, but guard your heart until you see sustained change. Other people. You need to depend on others to help you set and keep boundaries. People subject to another person's addictions, control, or abuse are finding that after years and years of loving too much, they can find the ability to create boundaries only through a support group. Their support system is giving them the strength to say no to abuse and to control for the first time in their lives. There are two reasons why you need others to help with boundaries. The first is that your most basic need in life is for relationship. People suffer much to have relationships, and many put up with abuse because they fear their partners will leave them and they will be alone if they stand up to them. Fear of being alone keeps many in hurtful patterns for years. They are afraid that if they set boundaries, they will not have any love in their life. When they open up themselves up to support from others, however, they find that the abusive person is not only the source of love in the world, and they can find the strength through their support system to set the limits they need to set. They are no longer alone. The Church of Christ is there to give strength to ward off the blows against them. The other reason we need others is because we need new input and teaching. Many people have been taught by their church or their family that boundaries are unbiblical, mean, or selfish. These people need good biblical support systems to help them stand against the guilt that comes from the old tapes inside that tells them lies to keep them in bondage. They need supportive others to stand against the old messages and the guilt involved in the change. In part 2, we will be discussing in greater detail how to build boundaries in all the primary relationships in your life. Our point for now is that boundaries are not built in a vacuum. Creating boundaries always involves a support network. Consequences. Trespassing on one other's or one other people's property carries consequences. No trespassing signs usually carry a threat of prosecution if someone steps over the boundaries. The Bible teaches this principle over and over, saying that if we walk one way, this will happen, and if we walk another way, something else will happen. Just as the Bible sets consequences for certain behaviors, we need to back up our boundaries with consequences. How many marriages could have been saved if one spouse has followed through with the heart of, "If you don't stop drinking, I will leave you until you get some treatment." Or how many young adults' lives would have been turned around if their parents had followed through with their threat of "no more money if you quit another job without having further employment," or "no bed if you continue to smoke marijuana in my house." Paul is not kidding in the 2 Thessalonians 3:10 when he says that if anyone will not work, don't let him or her eat. God does not enable irresponsible behavior. Hunger is a consequence of laziness. Consequences give good barbs to fences. They let people know the seriousness of the trespass and the seriousness of our respect for ourselves. This teaches them that our commitment to living according to helpful values is something we hold dear and will fight to protect and guard. What's within my boundaries? The story of the Good Samaritan is a model of correct behavior in many dimensions. It is a good illustration of boundaries, when they should be both observed and violated. Imagine for a moment how the story might read if the Samaritan were a boundaryless person. You know the story. A man traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho was mugged. The robbers stripped him and beat him, leaving him half dead. A priest and Levite passed by on the other side of the road, ignoring the hurt man, but a Samaritan took pity on him, bandaged his wounds, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day, the Samaritan gave the innkeeper some money and said, "Look after him. When I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have." Let's depart from the familiar story here. Suppose the injured man wakes up at this point in the story and says, "What, you are leaving?" "Yes, I am. I have some business in Jericho I have to attend to," the Samaritan replies. "Don't you think you are being selfish? I'm in pretty bad shape here. I'm going to need someone to talk to. How is Jesus going to use you as an example? You're not even acting like a Christian, abandoning me like this in my time of need. Whatever happened to deny yourself?" "Why, I guess you're right," the Samaritan says. "That would be uncaring of me to leave you here alone. I should do more. I will postpone my trip for a few days." So he stays with the man for 3 days, talking to him and making sure that he's happy and content. On the afternoon of the third day, there's a knock at the door and a messenger comes in. He hands the Samaritan a message from his business contacts in Jericho. "Waited us as long as we could, have decided to sell camels to another party. Our next herd will be here in 6 months. "How could you do this to me?" the Samaritan screams at the recovering man, waving the message in the air. "Look what you have done now. You have caused me to lose those camels that I needed for my business. Now I can't deliver my goods. This may put me out of business. How could you do this to me?" At same level, this story may be familiar to all of us. We may be moved with compassion to give to someone in need, but then this person manipulates us into giving more than we want to give. We end up resentful and angry, having missed something we needed in our own life. Or we may want more from someone else and we pressure them until they give in. They give not out of their heart and free will, but out of compliance, and they resent us for what they give. Neither one of us comes out ahead. To avoid these scenarios, we need to look at what falls within our boundaries and what we are responsible for. Feelings. Feelings have gotten a bad rap in the Christian world. They have been called everything from unimportant to fleshly. At the same time, example after example shows how our feelings play an enormous role in our motivation and behavior. How many times have you seen people do ungodly things to one another because of hurt feelings? Or how many times has someone had to be hospitalized for depression after years and years of trying to ignore the way they felt until they become suicidal? Feelings should neither be ignored nor placed in charge. The Bible says to own your feelings and be aware of them. They can often motivate you to do much good. The Good Samaritan's pity moved him to go to the injured Israelite. The father was killed with the compassion for his last son and threw his arms around him. Many times, Jesus had compassion for the people to whom he ministered. Feelings come from your heart and can tell you the state of your relationships. They can tell you if things are going well or if there is a problem. If you feel close and loving, things are probably going well. If you feel angry, you have a problem that needs to be addressed. But the point is, your feelings are your responsibility and you must own them and see them as your problem so you can begin to find an answer to whatever issue they are pointing to. Okay all, let's end up for today. In the coming sessions, we'll continue to see what the author talks about. What does a boundary look like? Thank you for continuously listening to our recordings. Have a wonderful day.